Very good morning, children. I am Lakshmi Narayana Gunta, PGT in Zoology at APMS and Junior College, Karvanja, and also working as NEET Super 60 faculty in Zoology at Super 60 Doppulavalsa, Srikakulam district. Today, we are going to discuss the structure of the human heart. Human heart is mesodermal in origin. And it is in the size of a clenched fist. This is the size of our heart. Mesoderma. It is formed from the mesoderm, embryonic mesoderm. We have already studied in our digestive system, which is formed from the endoderm. And connective tissues, they have been formed from the mesoderm. And nervous tissue, outer surface of the integumentary system, and also the enamel of the teeth, all these are ectodermal in origin, but this human heart is mesodermal in origin and it is in the size of a clenched fist. It is pear shaped structure, a pear fruit. You might have seen pear fruit. This is a pear shaped structure and it is located in the thoracic cavity in the mediastinum. This is the thoracic cavity and the mediastinum. Mediastinum is the cavity or the space present between the two lungs. It is located in the thoracic cavity and slightly bent towards the left side. Human heart, it is triangular in outline. Here you can observe in this picture. It is triangular shaped structure and wider at the anterior end and narrower at the posterior end. This is wider part, which is an anterior part, and at the posterior end it is narrower. Heart is covered by a double layered pericardium, the outer fibrous pericardium and the inner serous pericardium. Here you can observe the fibrous pericardium. Outer one is fibrous pericardium. This is fibrous pericardium and this one is the serous pericardium. Here you can clearly observe the fibrous pericardium and the serous pericardium. This one is fibrous pericardium and this one is serous pericardium. The serous pericardium is again having two layers. The outer layer is called as parietal layer and the inner layer is called as the visceral layer. The outer, this is the outer layer and this one is parietal layer and this one is visceral layer. And this visceral layer is also called as the epicardium. This is the epicardium, the outermost wall of the heart. Okay, the parietal and visceral layers, they are separated by a pericardial cavity. This one is the pericardial cavity, which is filled with pericardial fluid. This pericardial fluid, it protects the heart from external shocks. Here you can clearly observe, this one is the parietal layer and this one is the visceral layer. In between these two, there is a cavity called as pericardial cavity. This pericardial cavity is filled with pericardial fluid, which protects the heart from external shocks. Okay, coming to the walls of the heart. The walls of the heart, they are made up of three layers. The outermost layer is called as the epicardium. This one is epicardium. This one is the epicardial thin layer. And middle muscular layer is called as the myocardium. This one is myocardium, which is richly supplied with the cardiac muscles. These cardiac muscles, they are very much helpful in the pumping system of the heart. These cardiac muscles, they never undergo fatigue. Okay, and this is the thickest layer, that is the myocardium, and the innermost layer is endocardium. This one is the endocardium, which forms the inner wall of the heart. Heart is divided into four chambers by grooves. These four chambers, the upper two are atria and the lower two are ventricles. These are atria. These atria and ventricles, they are separated by a deep groove called as coronary sulcus. This deep groove, it is visible to us clearly from the outside, which separates the atria and ventricles. This is in the shape of a crown. You might have seen the kings, they are wearing the crown and it looks like the same thing. And that's why it is called as coronary sulcus, in which the coronary artery runs. Okay, and the two atria and the two ventricles, they are separated from each other by a muscular partition called as the septa. This partition which is present between the right ventricle and the left ventricle. This one is right ventricle and this one is left ventricle. Both of them, they are separated with a septum called as interventricular septum. Interventricular septum. And similarly, this one is right atrium and this one is left atrium. Both the right atrium and left atrium, they are separated by a septum called as interatrial septum. Interatrial septum. And similarly, the atria and ventricles, the upper atria and lower ventricles, they are separated from each other with a septum called as atrioventricular septum. Okay, coming to the next one. The right atrium is larger than the left atrium. This one is right atrium and this one is left atrium. Right atrium is larger than the left atrium. And similarly, the walls of the ventricles, they are relatively thicker than the atrial walls. The deoxygenated blood that is collected from all the parts of the body, it is collected into the right atrium. To the right atrium. That's why right atrium is larger. Whereas the left atrium receives the blood only from the lungs. Only from the lungs. And what about the next one? The walls of the ventricles, why they are relatively thicker than the walls of the atria? Because the ventricles, they have to pump blood to larger distances. Even to the larger distances, like to the tip of the toe, in order to exert more pressure, in order to withstand from the more pressure that is exerted by the walls, they become thicker. In the embryonic stages, this interatrial septum has a small pore called as foramen ovale. Foramen ovale. Here you can clearly observe the foramen ovale. The same is magnified here. This is the foramen. This foramen is called as foramen ovale. In the embryonic stages, interatrial septum has a small pore called as foramen ovale. And by the time of birth, when the lungs become functional, this foramen ovale, it gets closed, leaving a depression called as fossa ovalis. This depression is called as fossa ovalis. Why? What is the reason behind it? Why the foramen ovale, it is closed even immediately after birth? Because when we were in our mother's womb, the oxygen is supplied by our mother itself. And immediately after coming out from the womb, we have to make our own arrangements for this oxygen demand. That's why when the lungs become functional, the foramen ovale gets closed. And in some cases, this foramen ovale, it is not closed properly, and the condition is called as patent foramen ovale, in medical terms PFO. It can be corrected surgically later. Okay. And left atrium, it receives oxygenated blood from lungs through two pairs of pulmonary veins. Two pairs of pulmonary veins. Here you can clearly observe the two pairs of pulmonary veins. Generally, the veins, they carry in blood. They bring in the deoxygenated blood. But the only vein that brings in oxygenated blood to the heart are pulmonary veins. They are four in number. Pulmonary veins are four in number. These two and these two, they are open here in the left atrium. Okay. And right atrium, whereas this right atrium, it receives deoxygenated blood from all the parts of the body except from the lungs. Except from the lungs. The pre-caval vein, which is also called as the anterior vena cava, and post-caval vein, which is also called as posterior vena cava. Along with these two, there is also one more coronary sinus which brings in the deoxygenated blood from the walls of the heart. This way, the right atrium receives deoxygenated blood from all the parts of the body through pre-caval vein, post-caval vein, and the coronary sinus. Okay, coming to the next one. In the opening of the post-caval vein, this is the post-caval vein. At the opening of the post-caval vein into the right atrium, there is a valve present. That valve is called as the valve of Eustachian. The valve of
Eustachian.
This valve of Eustachian, it directs the blood from the right atrium to left atrium through this foramen ovale. To bypass the pulmonary circulation, this right atrium, it directs the blood to left atrium through this foramen ovale. That happens only because of this valve of Eustachian. That's why after birth, this Eustachian in adults, it becomes a vestigial one. Coming to the coronary circulation. Coronary circulation, it includes a pair of left and right coronary arteries and four coronary veins. In order to pump blood to all the parts, the cardiac muscles also, they need the blood. They need the blood and they also need the oxygen. Right and left coronary arteries, they supply the blood to the walls of the heart, and the deoxygenated blood formed in the walls of the heart, it is collected by four veins, and these four veins, they together open into coronary sinus, and from there they open into the right atrium. Okay, and the opening of the coronary sinus into right atrium is again guarded by a valve called as the valve of Tebbesses. Valve of Tebbesses is the valve present at the opening of the coronary sinus into the right atrium, and whereas the valve of Eustachian is the valve present at the opening of the posterior vena cava into the right atrium. Okay, and coming to the next one, the muscular ridges present in the inner walls of the inner surface of the ventricle are called as columnae corneae. Here and there, some columnae corneae, they become enlarged and they become conical shaped. These conical shaped enlarged columnae corneae are called as papillary muscles. These are papillary muscles. And coming to the openings between atria and ventricles are guarded by valves called as tricuspid valve and the bicuspid valve. These valves are also called as atrioventricular valves. Here you can clearly observe a tricuspid valve. This is a tricuspid valve which is present between right atrium and right ventricle, whereas the bicuspid valve, which is present between left atrium and left ventricle. This bicuspid valve is also called as mitral valve. Why this is called as mitral valve? Because you might have seen the popes, Pope John Paul I, Pope John Paul II, they are wearing a special cap-like structure. That is called as mitral. Okay. The valve which is present between the left atrium and left ventricle is in the shape of that mitral. That's why it is also called as mitral valve. Here you can observe this one is tricuspid valve and this one is bicuspid valve. In addition to these two valves, we also find the aortic valve and pulmonary valve. The rigid vessels are called as arteries. Arteries, they are thick, and you can observe the walls, artery walls, and whereas the veins, they are thin. The walls of the veins are thin. These arteries, they originate from the heart. A for away from heart. These arteries, they take away blood from the heart to various organs. Mostly, they take away the oxygenated blood, except the pulmonary artery, which carries the deoxygenated blood away from heart to the lungs. Okay. And the largest artery is the aorta or systemic arch. Systemic arch. Here you can observe the systemic arch. This is the largest artery which supplies the oxygenated blood to all the parts of the body from the left ventricle. This is also called a systemic arch or aorta. Okay. The largest artery. And the relatively smaller one is the pulmonary artery or pulmonary arch. This one is pulmonary artery. It supplies the deoxygenated blood to the both lungs from the right ventricle. Okay. And the less rigid vessels are called as veins, which bring in blood from various organs to the heart. These veins, mostly they carry in the deoxygenated blood. Arteries, they end with capillaries, and whereas these veins, they start with capillaries. Arteries, they always, mostly they carry oxygenated blood, whereas veins, they carry deoxygenated blood, except the pulmonary artery, which carries deoxygenated blood. except the pulmonary vein which carries the oxygenated blood. Artery walls, they are rigid. Walls of the vein, they are somewhat less rigid. And the veins, they are valvular. They have valves within them, whereas arteries, they lack valves. Okay. And arteries, they never collapse, whereas veins, they get collapsed when the blood is absent in them. Okay. Because the walls of the artery, they are thick, that's why they never collapse. Whereas the veins, walls of the veins, they are not that much of thick of artery, that's why they may collapse. Okay. And extending between the AV valves, I have already told you that tricuspid valve and bicuspid valve, these two valves, they are called as AV valves. And extending from the AV valves means from the tricuspid valve to papillary muscle and bicuspid valve to papillary muscles. Extending between AV valves and papillary muscles, tendon-like cords are present. These cords are called as heart strings or chordae tendinae. Here you can observe these cords. These cords are called as chordae tendinae, which are also called as heart strings. Here you can clearly observe the heart strings. Coming to the next one, aortic arches. The first one is left systemic arch. This one is the left systemic arch, is the aortic arch. It starts from the left ventricle and supplies oxygenated blood to all the parts of the body except the lungs. And at the base of this systemic arch, the aortic valve is present. This aortic valve, it allows the blood to pass from left ventricle to systemic arch only, but not vice versa. The next arch is the pulmonary arch. Pulmonary arch, it starts from the right ventricle and supplies deoxygenated blood to both the lungs. At the beginning of this pulmonary arch, pulmonary valve is present. This pulmonary valve, it always supplies blood from the right ventricle to the pulmonary arch, but not vice versa, but not in a reverse direction. At the point of contact of this systemic and pulmonary arches, this is the point of contact. Okay. A fibrous strand is present, that is called as ligamentum arteriosum. This ligamentum arteriosum, it is a remnant of ductus arteriosum. Can you tell me what is the use of this ligamentum arteriosum? I have already told you that during fetal stages, in order to bypass the pulmonary circulation, pulmonary arch, it directly supplies the blood to the systemic arch through this ligamentum arteriosum. This ligamentum arteriosum is considered to be the remnant of ductus arteriosum. Okay, coming to the nodal tissue. The nodal tissue found in heart are SA node and AV node. Okay, SA node is also called as the sinoatrial node. Sinoatrial node, it is present at the top right corner of the right atrium. Here you can clearly observe, very near to the opening of the superior vena cava. This is the superior vena cava. At the opening of the superior vena cava, this node is present. That is, node is called as sinoatrial node. This SA node is commonly called as the pacemaker of the heart. Why it is called as the pacemaker of heart? Because it can generate some action potential for every 0.6 seconds. It generates these action potential with its own, but not under the control of central nervous system. That's why it is called as the pacemaker of the heart. And coming to the next nodal tissue, the AV node. AV node. This AV node, which is present at the lower left corner of the right atrium, at the opening of the coronary sinus, this AV node or atrioventricular node is also called as a relay unit, because it catches the electrical impulses generated from the SA node, and in turn it supplies the same electrical impulses to the ventricles. That's why it is called as a relay unit. And let us finish this session with a few questions. Okay, are you ready? Okay, the first one is, ligamentum arteriosum is a remnant of ductus aorticus, ductus arteriosus, ductus deferens and the ductus ejaculatorius. What is your option? Okay, that's right. Ductus arteriosus. Okay, next question. In humans, number of coronary arteries and coronary veins respectively are, how many coronary arteries and coronary veins are there in humans? The options are 2 and 4, 4 and 2, 2 and 2 and 4 and 4. What's your option? That's right. 2 and 4. The option is 2 and 4. And coming to the next question, last question. Large and conical ridges in the ventricles of heart are, the first option is caudate edinae and columnae corneae, papillary muscles and columns of Burtini. Which one is the right option? Yes, right. The papillary muscles is the right option. Okay, thank you for watching the video. And if you want to watch more videos regarding this NEET and NSET, you can follow me on YouTube simply by typing Lakshmi Narayana. Thank you very much.